And so just really quickly, welcome back everybody to the Dharma Doors. Obviously I'm MC Owens and this is the San Francisco Dharma Collective. And tonight, the theme for tonight, the subject that we're going to be focusing on is the topic of Pariṇāmanā, P-A-R-I-N-A. M-A-N-A, Pariṇāmanā. And you could translate Pariṇāmanā, well, the way that it's normally translated as is the transference of merit. Now, I want you to know right away that the word Pariṇāmanā doesn't mean transference of merit. It means something like just transformation. Pariṇāmanā, to transform or convert. But it is normally within the world of Buddhism referred to as the transference of merit. So as usual, I'm going to start us off with a kind of a brief Dharma talk about this idea. I have some things to say about it in general, some things to say about it specifically. And then as usual, we're going to transition back to our sutra where it will make sense that we have spent some time talking about this idea of Pariṇāmanā. But we'll hold off on the sutra and let's dive into this topic. So even though you probably don't, you may not have heard this word Pariṇāmanā before, it's not one of the more popular Sanskrit words, but even if you haven't heard of it, you probably know about this. And I say that because it has become such an important part of Buddhist practice. And basically what it is that you're probably familiar with it as at the conclusion of a meditation or the conclusion of a ceremony or a ritual or a chanting of a sutra, but at the concluding of a practice, there will be the transference of the merit that was accumulated by doing that practice, by doing whatever it was, a Buddhist ceremony, or again, any kind of practice, traditionally concludes with this transferring of the merit to or for the benefit of all sentient beings. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk a little bit about, you know, what's that all about? And we're going to talk a little bit about what I know of as the history of that, how it kind of became a part of Buddhism. And then again, we're going to see it in action in the sutra. So yes, today, the transference of merit ceremony at the end of a something has become, that's kind of become very standard. So I want to begin with like just some like, I don't know what you would call it, maybe anthropology, but just I want to zoom way out and look at what we're talking about. So what we're going to talk about tonight, it's not at all exclusive to Buddhism. What's unique about Buddhism is this transference of the merit to all sentient beings for the welfare of all sentient beings. That's going to be the Buddhist part. But this idea of Pariṇāmanā, this idea of the transformation, though, that is not exclusive to Buddhism. And what I mean is that, oh, you know, when I really started thinking about this, it's much more common than kind of even I first thought. And what I'm kind of want to point at or what I want to get at is, I'm going to use a fun example. So I'm going to start with a fun example, or at least what I think is an interesting example. And then we'll talk about other examples. But what I'm thinking about is, and I assume there's actually two groups of people in the audience or two sorts of people watching this. One sort that is going to be like, ah, I know what you're talking about. And another sort that's going to be like, wait, what are you talking about? And the example that I want to use is basically kind of an example that would come to us from the world of magic. So the idea is that if you do some sort of magic, and I'm not talking about, you know, pulling rabbits out of hats. I'm not talking about that kind of magic. I'm talking about supernatural, you know, magic in that way. And there's a particular type of magic actually that I'll refer to. And this is where many of you may have heard of this, but some of you might not have heard of this. So the particular type of magic that I'm thinking of is what would be called sigil magic. That's a S-I-G-I-L, if you're curious. And a sigil is a symbol. It's the root of that word. Sigil is a sign or a symbol. And what that type of magic is about, and there's different forms of this type of magic, by the way. But to put it very, very, very simply, you would construct, create, draw a symbol, and you would be focusing an intent, an intention, and imbuing this symbol with that intention. And that intention could be kind of anything. Again, this will vary depending on the type of magic that you're doing, but the idea of imbuing this symbol with this intention. And then in some forms of sigil magic, you would burn the drawing that you made of the symbol. There are other techniques for working with the sigil after you create it, after you have imbued it with the intention. But the idea here is that you are doing or performing a kind of a ritual, a kind of a performance, a ceremony of some sort. And then in order to kind of make it work, you need to kind of kick it into gear. You need to send it on its way, so to speak. And again, you might burn the sigil or bury it. There's various techniques. But my point is that this idea of doing some sort of work, call it metaphysical work, and then dedicating that work towards something. This is an example of this transformation in a way, or this, I don't even know what to call this actually. It's so, by the way, here's another very simple, very interesting example of what I'm talking about. Blowing out birthday candles. So the idea is that you make a wish, and then you blow out the candles. And the idea is that if you had just made the wish, but you didn't blow out the candles, it wouldn't have worked. You'd make the wish, and then you perform the thing that then kicks it into action. And so whether it's something as simple as a birthday wish, if it's something complicated like sigil magic, or even if you get into the realm of religion and you are now thinking, or I am thinking about prayer and the idea of sort of maybe in the Catholic tradition, it's about having a prayer and lighting a candle and therefore doing something to sort of cause the wish to happen. Whatever that is, that's what we're talking about tonight. And again, it's so subtle because when I first started thinking about this, probably last week, it was sort of like, oh, you know, this is a really strange thing, the transference of merit. But then when I started thinking more about it, I was like, you know, we actually do this in a lot of ways all over the place. And so very interesting that it's kind of a common theme in that way. Now, once again, I want to make it really clear that if you were doing like a birthday wish, normally we have a very, you know, specific wish in mind, you know, whatever it might be, but it's this sort of idea of like, you know, I want to go to Paris next year. So then that's your wish. You blow out your candle and you kind of set that wish on its way. So, you know, something very simple like a trip, or if you're doing that complicated sigil magic I was talking about, it could be something more complicated, but nonetheless, it would still be a very specific goal in that way, something very specific that you're trying to accomplish. And then even, of course, if it's praying to God for, you know, somebody to get well, somebody's sick and you're praying to God, and then you do a ritual to hope that they get better. All of those examples are these very specific intentions. Whereas the Pariṇāmanā that we're talking about, at least in the beginning, and this is where it's going to get complicated, but when you look at the earliest Buddhist references to this idea of Pariṇāmanā, it is always about transferring merit to all sentient beings. And that there's in many ways, it's only Pariṇāmanā if it's being dedicated to all sentient beings. Otherwise, we might not even want to use that word Pariṇāmanā anymore. Let me go a little deeper. So I mentioned just now a couple of times actually that Pariṇāmanā is about the transference of merit. What is being called merit here is punya, P-U-N-Y-A, punya. Punya is this idea of merit. And the idea, of course, and we don't, it, you know, when I say we, but in English, in the West, we don't exactly have this idea of punya. Some people do, of course, but I mean, culturally at large, we don't really quite have this idea of punya. And what punya is about is basically that if I do something good, if I do something virtuous, I get punya, I get merit. And punya is, of course, metaphysical, it's not tangible, but it is, in a sense, quantifiable, meaning like you build it up, meaning if I did two good things, I get extra merit. And if I did three good things, I get more merit than just two, and so on and so on. And so what the idea is that, so before the Buddha, before Buddhism, in India, the generally understood idea was that all sentient beings are cruising around the cycle of birth, death, and rebirth. They're cruising around samsara, being born, living a life, dying, being reborn, living a life, and so on. And you, of course, know that there have always been considered these kind of upper, better rebirths, rebirth as a human, rebirth as a god. And there's been these lower rebirths, rebirth as a hungry ghost, even rebirth in hell. And so the idea is, well, what determines whether I go and get reborn as a human again, or even reborn as a god, or I go down and become reborn as a hungry ghost or a hell dweller. What determines that? Punya. One's accumulation of punya. So the idea was, is that one can do something good, accumulate punya, and if I store up enough punya over my life, then when I die, tradition says, I go before Yama, I go before the judge of the dead, and my punya is basically put on a scale. And depending upon the amount of punya, the amount of merit versus demerit, or kind of no bad merit in that sense, based upon that, I'm reborn as a god or I'm reborn as a hungry ghost. And the point of all of that, by the way, was that Yama, the judge or the lord of the dead, Yama has no say over the matter. Yama sort of doles out the rebirth, but that was all up to us, was the idea that we're the ones that are accumulating merit or not. And so we're the ones that are creating our future rebirth, wherever it might be in that way. And so there were always within the world of Buddhism, or actually I should say within the world of India, there were a variety of ways to accumulate merit. Now, the thing about it is that within when the Buddha came on the scene and when Buddhism came on the scene, being an Indian religion, being an Indian cultural tradition, they continued this idea of the accumulation of merit. The idea, though, is that in the normal mode, meaning not Buddhist, I'm over here accumulating merit, and my merit's my merit, and your merit's your merit, and the amount of merit that I accumulate is the amount of merit I accumulate, and that goes to my rebirth, or you know, depends on my rebirth. That's it, and you're doing that. Everybody's doing that. All sentient beings are accumulating punya or not. And I'll tell you now that within the early Buddhist tradition, what would be called the Hinayana, there's a pretty agreed upon mainline understanding when it comes to punya. And that is that everybody's responsible for their own punya, and that basically punya is not transferable. In the early tradition, everybody was looking out for themselves and could only look out for themselves in that sense. In the Mahayana tradition, though, this changes. This whole idea changes. And eventually, well, it changes where the transference of merit to other beings, meaning that I have accumulated punya for my good acts, but rather than utilizing that punya for my own benefit, there are processes of transferring that punya to others that will help their rebirth. Again, it's a pretty well-established idea that the Hinayana did not do this, that they didn't transfer merit, they weren't into transferring merit, nor did they even really believe that it was possible to do this. The Mahayana comes along, establishes that it is possible in a way, and I want to talk about that. I actually want to spend more time talking about the early Mahayana idea of transferring merit. What I want you to know, though, because I might not get back to this, as time goes on, though, within the world of Mahayana Buddhism, it does start to become the tradition of transferring merit to specific people, not just to all sentient beings, but actually like to my deceased parents, for example. That was a really big one, a really big, very important one in early Mahayana, or in early Buddhism. It was the transferring it to one's deceased parents was a big one. And eventually then, if you were to go to, say, Japan today, or you could go to a lot of Buddhist countries, but I've been to Japan a number of times and so can speak to this firsthand. But if you go to Japan, the Buddhists are doing transference of merit for all kinds of things. I mean, we're talking about for getting raises, for getting, you know, wealth, prosperity, all kinds of things they are transferring merit to. I don't really want to get into that, meaning the weeds of modern Buddhism and the, you know, it's tricky. So I want to focus on like the early advent of this idea of Pariṇāmanā. This will have a lot to do with the sutra we're going to read tonight, because this sutra is definitely going to be one of those very early Mahayana presentations of this idea of Pariṇāmanā. So, yeah, and it's kind of an interesting reading that I would love to just be able to read for you. So let me tell you some background information to help help this make sense. So, yeah, let me just kind of break down what I think is going on with this Pariṇāmanā. So, one of the things to be considering is I just kind of broke down for you the basics of this punya business. Remember, it's about performing good acts, accumulating punya, so that I could get a better rebirth and avoid a poorer rebirth, right? So right there, we have a kind of an issue, if you will. And that issue is that Buddhists in general, whether they're Hinayana or Mahayana, Buddhists are trying to get out of the cycle of samsara. Buddhists traditionally, in that sense, are not trying to get a better rebirth. And by the way, our sutra has told us, and many Mahayana sutras will tell you, that a bodhisattva, a seeker of enlightenment, doesn't avoid the lower rebirths, actually may willingly take on rebirth in a lower realm in order to benefit the beings in those lower realms. So right there, we, again, there's kind of an issue, which is that Buddhists, especially the monastics, they're accumulating a tremendous amount of merit for their virtuous activities. By the way, I got to tell you, even in a lot of forms of magic, just to go back to that for a second, in a lot of forms of magic, and definitely in Buddhism, you earn punya by being celibate. It's one of those things that just by virtue of not having sex and not kind of giving into sexual desire in that way, one traditionally accumulates punya. It's just one of many ways. But my point is, the Buddhist monastics are just sitting over there clocking in punya after punya after punya for their benefit, for their good acts in that way. They tell the truth. They take vows to tell the truth all the time. So that's accumulating punya. That's accumulating good merit. They're nonviolent. They're not killing. That's accumulating good merit. And so a monk or a nun or any Buddhist in that sense who's doing the or following the precepts is accumulating a lot of merit. But the thing about it is that a good Buddhist, again, is not trying to get a better rebirth. If they're a bodhisattva in that way, they're not trying to avoid a lower rebirth. So what do we do with all of this merit, right? Well, again, in the Hinayana, what happens is that a monk or a nun who has all of this punya, they become, it's hard to explain. You might already know this, but if you don't, it's hard to explain. But in the Hinayana, what happens is they talk about a monk or a nun who has been accumulating the punya. They will refer to a monk or a nun in that way as a field of merit, a punya kshetra. And what that means is that if I, as a lay Buddhist, so not a monk, but a lay Buddhist, if I give the monk or the nun something, I get more punya than I would get if I gave it to just some regular person on the street. So what happens in the Hinayana is that the monk or the nun creates all of this punya, which makes them basically like a punya magnifier. They can like magnify punya. They can't transfer it traditionally. I know somebody eventually is going to comment and say, no, they do that in Thailand. And it's like, I know they do that in Thailand now. But the point is back in the day, monks and nuns were accumulating punya, becoming punya magnifiers. And then people could donate to them to get extra punya to help them either get a better rebirth, or if they're a Buddhist, like a lay Buddhist, then interestingly, the accumulation of punya by a lay Buddhist is going towards their being reborn as someone who will renounce and become a monk or a nun. Like that's, and the reason why I point that out is because in the Hinayana, in the early form of Buddhism, the monks and the nuns were the real Buddhists. And the lay community, they were the support network for the quote real Buddhists. And that's sort of very much a part of the economy of punya that goes on in the Hinayana, where there is this kind of very much this idea of punya, the buildup of punya, punya's relationship to rebirth, but it has this sort of different, slightly different, but in many ways very different connotation. Where it's you're accumulating this not to just to get a better rebirth, you're accumulating this to get out of samsara. That's the idea. So that's in the Hinayana. The Mahayana, which is again all about the Bodhisattva path, the Bodhisattva path is kind of very different than all of that. So the Bodhisattva path, as we have been talking about for many Sunday nights now, because for many Sundays in a row, I've been only talking about the Bodhisattva path, what constitutes the Bodhisattva path. The one idea, or one idea that I've been really emphasizing, is that in the early Hinayana, one basically made the vow to get enlightened, meaning, I'm going to get enlightened. I'm going to enter nirvana. I'm going to alleviate my suffering. That's my vow. It might take a few lifetimes, but I am going to eventually alleviate my suffering. That's my vow. If I'm in the Hinayana, what makes a bodhisattva is they make the vow to bring all sentient beings to awakening, to alleviate the suffering of all sentient beings, not just their own suffering. That's a very different path in a way. If one's intention is, this is all for everybody. This is all for everybody. So within that framework, the bodhisattva is definitely a virtuous person, definitely accumulating boatloads of merit. But within the Mahayana, they introduce this technique. Let's call it a technique. They introduce this technique of Pariṇāmanā. I said at the opening, Pariṇāmanā means to transform, to like, pari is like complete or total. Namana, as far as I can, I mean, I'm trying to do the etymology on this word, but it's about this radical transformation, like a complete transformation. And the idea of it is, well, as I've already mentioned, the idea is that within this framework of the Pariṇāmanā, a bodhisattva can transfer their accumulated merit to others. Again, traditionally to all sentient beings in that way. And I've probably even spoken about it more than I wanted to. What I probably have spoken about more than I wanted to is this debate. It's this kind of Buddhist debate about whether you can transfer merit to other people or not. And people get real geeky about this question about whether you can transfer merit to other people or not. And I'm not actually really interested in that kind of dogmatic debate, because here's what I think is going on with the idea of Pariṇāmanā. There's a great book. You've probably read it. It's one of those classic Buddhist books that everybody's read, by Chungnyam Trungpa Rinpoche, the Cutting Through Spiritual Materialism, I believe it is. In that book, he talks about spiritual materialism. And it's the idea that, yeah, we can get attached to our creature comforts. We can get attached to our stuff. We can get attached to social status. We can get attached to a lot of material, worldly things. And when we start maybe practicing Buddhism or some other spiritual path, we may be able, I would hope, but we may be able to relinquish, let go of materiality and worldly things, like really realizing that it's kind of like, you know, like St. Paul says, they're toys, it's all childish things. So to grow up in that way and let them put down one's childish toys and creature comforts and things, one can become a spiritual practitioner. Well, the idea of spiritual materialism is the idea that we can start to have that same kind of attachment to spirituality. And now all of a sudden, I'm going down to South America and I'm doing my ayahuasca ceremony and I'm wearing that as like a badge of honor that I've accomplished. I've journeyed. Right? I've journeyed with the shamans in the Amazon. Oh, and then I went to Ulaanbaatar and I drank the fermented yak's milk with the Tibetan lamas. And then I did this. And so there's a way in which spirituality and spiritual things and even kind of spiritual accomplishments can become attachments just as easily as a fancy car or anything else. So it could be that we actually need to do more work in even letting go of those attachments to spiritual things. So the way that I understand the bodhisattva practice of Pariṇāmanā is that it is dealing with this idea of, I did something good and I got all this punya. I'm such a great person. You know, big pat on the back. I'm such a great person. For me, the transference of merit to all sentient beings, the transformation is taking place in the mind of the bodhisattva. The transformation is about the bodhisattva actually still clinging to this idea of me doing good things. I'm better than you. How many good things did you do today? I did a lot. And that idea of holding that punya. And so rather than holding the punya and being like, I'm such a good person, I did all of this good stuff, the bodhisattva bundles up all of that accumulated punya and transfers it to the benefit of all sentient beings. And I gotta tell you that if you have ever dabbled in magic, it's why I used that example at the beginning. If you've ever dabbled in magic, somebody who is actually really interested in magic, they would think transferring that to all sentient beings was a tremendous waste of your effort. You mean you did that whole ritual? You stayed up all night on a full moon night and you killed how many chickens and you just gave it all away like that? That was a lot of work that you put into that. And the idea here, of course, is that the bodhisattva does not look at it like that, is the idea. In fact, they are working on overcoming that very mentality in that sense of even getting attached to the results of one's actions in that sense. And there's a lot. I would really like to read the sutra, so I won't say too much, but there's a lot going on with this Pariṇāmanā business. And what I mean is like, as a practice, this is like a really, really powerful practice. And so on the one hand, of course, it's working even more on that attachment to that sense of self, of course, because so much of that idea of the generating or the cultivating of punya, it's very much about what I did or what I didn't do and all of that. And so by the way, too, within the world of Buddhism, you will normally hear the language of whatever merit was generated from this practice, may it go to benefit all sentient beings. And it's this idea of like, I don't know how good this was, but whatever, if any good came out of this, I transfer it for the benefit of all sentient beings. So there's just a way that, there's a way that it's working on the sense of self. There's the way that it's working on that idea of accumulating more stuff, even though it's metaphysical punya, it's still the mentality of accumulation, the mentality of acquisition in that sense. And so rather than being like this, it's like that. So if you weren't looking at the screen, so rather than it being this action of moving towards me, of I got all this merit. I generated all this punya. And there's the movement of holding it versus the movement of letting go. And I would, you know, I'm making this gesture all the time on Sunday nights because I'm always talking about the Buddhist idea of either giving, letting go, non-attachment, what have you. So the Pariṇāmanā is an even deeper level of working on attachments, working on, again, that sense of self. And for me, the big one, and I'll eventually, there's a better sutra that's more about this idea. Maybe I'll do it sometime. But for me, what's really interesting is the Pariṇāmanā, the transference of merit, it really, really works on the transactional nature of a lot of this. Like this idea of like, oh, I gave you a donation. Where's my punya? Like I do this, I get this. And ultimately that becomes, at least from the Bodhisattva point of view, very problematic. That everything is this one for one. I gave you this, or you or the universe gives me this amount of punya. And the idea here is, and I've mentioned this on other Sunday nights, from the Bodhisattva's point of view, they're working on this practice of not distinguishing gift, giver, or recipient. And I say this a lot on Sunday nights, or I have said it in the past, which is that I actually don't know who is giving what to whom on these Sunday night Dharma talks. Yeah, I'm up here talking about the Dharma, and therefore it would seem like I'm the giver. But as I have often said, I get so much out of these classes. I'm working on these translations that I want to share with everybody. And so preparing for these gets me to work on them. Your questions challenge me. And so in the end, when I show up here on a Sunday night, I don't know who's giving what to whom. I don't know who is the giver, who's the recipient. And I certainly don't know what the gift is in that sense. But the idea is that there's something going on. And of course, whatever merit is generated from this going on, we transfer to all sentient beings. But the point is that the Bodhisattva is like really trying not to reify all of these things, gift, giver, recipient. And so a great way to not do that, just keep it moving. Just as they say, paying it forward, just keeping the punya moving in that sense. And so again, this idea of Pariṇāmanā, it's got a lot going for it, just for the Bodhisattva. And what I'm getting at is I guess what I'm trying to say is, even if merit can't be transferred to other people, this is still a great practice for the Bodhisattva. Now, if merit can be transferred to other beings, well, then now we're really talking, right? But my point is that it is a practice. It is a practice that makes sense any which way. In that sense. Okay, any questions, comments, answers, or ideas about Pariṇāmanā? Cool. So excellent. So now we can jump back to our wonderful sutra. Tonight is actually it's a very special night. It's a very special night because if you remember, a long time ago, we started reading this sutra. And as I've told you, there are two English translations of this sutra, one from the Chinese, which is in our book, A Treasury of Mahayana Sutras, And there's another version from Tibetan that's on the website, read 84,000. And that's the link that's in the chat. And so I've been reading between the two of those. I've also been working on my own translation. So we have all of that. And what I told you a long time ago was that the name of this sutra in Chinese is the Bodhisattva Mañjuśrī's Vyakaranya Sutra, the prediction of Mañjuśrī Bodhisattva's enlightenment. So the idea of receiving the prediction of enlightenment, we've talked about that. There have been other sutras where we've dealt with that. But there's this thing that happens in these more kind of fantastical Mahayana Buddhist sutras. There's this thing that happens where a bodhisattva will figure out either they would develop the patient tolerance for the birthlessness of all phenomena, or they will purify their dharma eye, or something will happen. And then the Buddha will make a prediction, this Vyakaranya, and they will say, oh, so-and-so just figured it out. One day, they're going to be a fully enlightened Buddha. And usually the Buddha will say what the name of that person will be when they are a Buddha. So this is, again, it's a common thing that happens in these Mahayana sutras. And this sutra, again, at least in the Chinese, is called the Mañjuśrī Vyakaranya Sutra. So the whole sutra is about this prediction of Manjushri's enlightenment. And of course, if you've been coming, you know that we've reached a point in the sutra where Mañjuśrī, Bodhisattva of wisdom, has been discoursing with another bodhisattva. And this other bodhisattva, thunderous voice, lion courage, bodhisattva, has been asking Mañjuśrī about his awakening, his anuttara samyak sambodhi, this complete unsurpassable enlightenment of a Buddha. And at first, the bodhisattva asked Mañjuśrī, when will you become awakened, fully awakened? When are you going to become a Buddha? And Mañjuśrī had a problem with that way of thinking, had a problem with that way of framing the question. The idea of, when will I in the future achieve awakening? And he basically says, yeah, you don't want to ask it like that. And has a really great conversation that I won't go into, because that would take all night to just revisit that. But then after that gets resolved, the bodhisattva asks Mañjuśrī again, okay, how long ago did you generate bodhicitta? So like, how long ago did you decide to become awakened? So rather than pointing to the future of when will Bodhisattva Mañjuśrī become awakened, we get asked, well, when did they even set out on the path? And Mañjuśrī won't answer that question either. And at that point, the bodhisattva, thunderous voice, lion courage, says to the Buddha, Buddha, Mañjuśrī won't tell us how long ago he generated bodhicitta, but we all want to know. And the Buddha says, noble one, Mañjuśrī is one who is profoundly patient. Within such profound kshanti, such profound patience, awakening nor mind can be found, nor can they be attained. There being nothing to find, for this reason, the bodhisattva doesn't say. And so I will now explain how long ago Mañjuśrī generated bodhicitta. So I mentioned way long ago about the way these Mahayana sutras work. And I mentioned a long time ago that these work in the form of a trilectical, where there's three voices, and it's a student, a bodhisattva, and the Buddha. And this is a great example of how they're going to use the fact that there's these three voices. Because, of course, what they're talking about, or it's not, I mean, they're talking about a lot, but a lot of Mañjuśrī, a lot of his like dharmic, his like dharmic Aikido, where the bodhisattva is coming out with a question and Mañjuśrī is like, nope, nope. It has a lot to do, of course, with this idea of the self. Buddhist awakening is like defined as the crystal clear understanding that there is no self. So at that point, it becomes a little difficult for someone like Mañjuśrī to say, oh, I'll get enlightened in a week. Or I generated bodhicitta so long ago. There's a way in which Mañjuśrī is smart enough to not think that way and not answer the question that way. And so the sutra is rather clever by allowing Mañjuśrī to not have to speak for himself in that way, but have the authority of the Buddha speak on his behalf. So I just wanted to point out how subtle these sutras are in the way that the story is doing a lot. So now we're going to hear from the Buddha about Mañjuśrī and when he first generated Anuttara Samyak, or the bodhicitta, the mind to develop Anuttara Samyak Sambodhi. Because I don't want to interrupt the reading, I just want to tell you one thing. In a moment, seconds, the sutra is going to talk about a king. And the king has a very interesting name. The name of the king, if you read the Tibetan, which is from the Sanskrit, the name of the king is given as Akasha, which means space, or just vacuous space, empty space, Akasha. I want you to know, though, that in the Chinese, the king is not quite called space or Akasha. The name definitely refers to space, and I would just as easily refer to this person as King Space. But because of the interesting Chinese term, it's a two-character term, I want to go with translating this name as ubiquity. Ubiquity is a beautiful word. It's a beautiful English word, beautiful idea. But this idea of being ubiquitous, being kind of everywhere, right? That is the name of this king, King Ubiquity. But it refers to how space is ubiquitous, is everywhere in that way. But that, just keep that in mind, though. Keep all of that in mind. When I refer to this person as King Ubiquity, just remember that it's King Space. All right. So, Noble One, in the past, as many kalpas ago as 700,000 myriad times that of the sands of the Ganges River, there was a Buddha named thunderous voice. Thus come one, worthy one, rightly awakened one, manifest in the world. To the east of here, past 72 Nayutas of Buddha lands, there was a world named Anudpata, unborn or unarisen, wherein that thunderous voice, thus come one, Tathagata, was explaining the Dharma. There were 84 billion Nayutas of voice hearer Shravakas and twice as many Bodhisattvas as that in attendance. Noble one, at that time, there was a king named Ubiquity, replete with the seven treasures, king of the four continents, ruling by the right reason of the correct Dharma as a wheel-turning Dharma king. For 84,000 years, he venerated and made offerings of clothing and sustenance and food and drink and palaces, towers, attendants and assistants, everything most excellent and wonderful, giving it all to thunderous voice, thus come when, and all the bodhisattvas and the great gathering of voice hearers. Among King Ubiquity's royal family, the empress, princesses, princes, and ministers, all they did was make offerings to the Buddha, going on for years and years without ever growing tired. After all that, that King Ubiquity sat alone in a quiet place and thought, I have now accumulated many great good roots, but I have not yet decided where to transfer them. Should it be towards becoming a Shakra Devanam Indra god, a Brahma heavenly king, perhaps a wheel-turning sage king? Do I transfer it towards being a voice hearer, or even a Pratekya Buddha, a solitary enlightened one? After hearing his thoughts, all the devas in the sky said to the king, great king, do not bring forth such an inferior, narrow-minded vow. Why? The king, having accumulated such a great amount of merit, should generate anuttara samyak sambodhicitta, the mind for unsurpassable awakening. Noble one, after King Ubiquity heard these words, he was joyful and thought, I will not regress from this with certainty. And why? Because the devas in heaven know my mind, and that is why they came to speak to me. Noble one, at that time, that King Ubiquity, along with a great assembly of 80 billion Nayutas of sentient beings, all went and bowed their heads to the feet of thunderous voice Buddha, circumambulating him seven times to the right, bowing their heads respectfully, and joining their palms toward the Buddha. And the king said, I now ask the supremely honored one, hoping that he will explain for me how one can attain perfection as a supremely honored one among human beings. To the refuge of the world, I have made vast offerings. With an uncertain mind, I never knew where to transfer them. Having cultivated such vast great merit, how should it be transferred? To seek the position of a Brahma god, a Shakra, or a wheel-turning king? To seek to becoming a voice hearer or a solitary Buddha? And when I generated these thoughts, gods from the sky said to me, great king, you should not give rise to such narrow-minded transference. For all sentient beings, you should make a broad, great vow. And for the benefit of the world, you should generate bodhicitta. I now request the world-honored one, sovereign one, over all dharmas, wishing for an explanation upon bodhicitta, the upaya, the expedient of generating it. Please explain. Having generated bodhicitta, to attain knowledge as the Muni has, as the sage has, only wishing for the honored one among gods and humans to explain for me. Then the thus come one, thunderous voice, replied to King Ubiquity, saying, great king, listen closely. I will explain step by step. All conditioned phenomena are in accord with the conditions of the desires of the faculties. As we wish, the results attained are like that. In my past lives, I also generated bodhicitta for the sake of all sentient beings, wishing to benefit them all. As I wished, as I had generated bodhicitta, I attained non-regression from awakening. And my mind's wish was quickly fulfilled. Great King, be steadfast in cultivating all conditioning, and you will attain the broad, great, unsurpassable awakening of a Buddha. When King Ubiquity heard the Buddha's explanation, he was most delighted, more delighted than he had ever been. And before the assembled gathering, he made the great lion's roar and then spoke in verse, saying, now, before this entire assembly, I generate the great bodhicitta for each and every sentient being, vowing that now until the end of all time, I will take on immeasurable lives, immeasurable deaths, thereby performing great benefit for sentient beings, cultivating the practices of bodhisattvas, and rescuing all beings from suffering. From now on, if I break this vow and give rise to an angry or greedy mind, or a stingy or envious, resentful or mad angry mind, then I will have deceived the Buddhas of the 10 directions. Also, from this day forward, until achieving awakening, I will always study the ways of the Buddhas, cultivating the pure practices they have taught, being in accord with the pure precepts, and swiftly transcending all transgressions. I will also, in regard to awakening, not wish to realize it swiftly, but until the end of the future, I shall broadly benefit all beings, adorning all Buddha lands, immeasurable, inconceivable numbers of them. And the roar of my name shall be heard universally throughout the realms of the 10 directions. I now predict of myself that I am certain to become a Buddha with pure, superior resolve. In this, I am firm without doubt. I will purify the three karmas of body, speech, and mind, and cause no evil to arise. And by this reality, I will become a Buddha, an honored one among human beings. If this citta, if this generation of bodhicitta is really real, may the ground shake in six different ways. If what I say is truly true, not something false and vacuous, may there be from within the vacuousness of sky, the sound of music spontaneously playing. If I am sincere, without deception, nor with a hateful filled mind, then due to that reality, may it rain Mandarava flowers. And when King Ubiquity had said these verses, because his chitta, because his mind was truly real, billions of Buddha lands in the 10 directions shook in six different ways. From the sky, the sound of music spontaneously played, and it rained Mandarava flowers. Then 2 billion of the king's attendants rejoiced and said to themselves with delight, we shall attain supreme unsurpassable awakening and study the king's generating of bodhicitta. The Buddha, our Buddha, then said to the great assembly, this King Ubiquity of that time, who was that person? Why, they are the Mañjuśrī of today. In the past, as many kalpas ago as incalculable sands of 700,000 Ganges, rivers, and more, he first generated bodhicitta. Then, after kalpas as numerous as the sands of 64 Ganges rivers, he attained the patient tolerance for the birthlessness of all phenomena, was able to complete the 10 bhumi stages of a bodhisattva, attained the 10 powers of a tathagata, completely fulfilling all of the unique dharmas of the stage of Buddhahood. Yet, never once did he give rise to the thought, I will become a Buddha. Noble one, at that time, 20 billion sentient beings who attended on that king also generated bodhicitta in the presence of thunderous voice Buddha and were all persuaded by Mañjuśrī to practice the six paramitas. And those 2 billion sentient beings have all now attained Anuttara Samyak Sambodhi, have all turned the great Dharma wheel, have all done the work of the Buddha, and have all entered Parinirvana, the final Nirvana. Mañjuśrī has already made offerings to all those Tathagatas and has protected and upheld all their Buddha Dharma. There's only one Buddha left called Earth Upholder. Below here, past as many lands as the number of sands in 40 Ganges rivers, where that Buddha's world is called Earth Upholder. There are also incalculable numbers of voice hearers there, and the Buddha's lifespan is immeasurable. And he is here right now. When the circumstances of Mañjuśrī's past were explained, 7,000 beings from among the assembly all generated Anuttara Samyak Sambodhi Citta. All right. So that concludes that section. So the first thing that I want to say about all of that is it's definitely, you know, unfortunate that, you know, that we're so far away from the beginning of the sutra. And what I mean is, you know, you're one is normally advised to read a sutra in one sitting. There's a way in which if you kind of read it and then put it down for a while and then start reading it again, there's a momentum that builds up. It's like music that way, frankly. You can't just jump into the middle of a song. You have to hear the beginning of the song. It's a different middle than if you just drop the needle right in the middle of the song, right? So my point is that this has been a very wild sutra. I mean, it started in one place, then we went to another place, but then the Buddha emitted light and all these bodhisattvas came from all these other realms. And then the Buddha was telling us about this. And my point is that this story about King Ubiquity, it's very much part of the whole first part of the sutra. And so if, you know, it's been a while since we talked about all of that, but just a few things that I want to point out. So two things of note. When the Buddha, our Buddha, starts to tell the Bodhisattva about where Mañjuśrī is from, right? It was a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, is basically what the sutra said. And there was this king who, again, was named Space, Akasha or Ubiquity. But I want you to notice that the Buddha of that world so long ago, where King Ubiquity made offerings, the name of that Buddha was Thunderous Voice, right? And the point that I want to make is that's oddly reminiscent of the name of the Bodhisattva who's asking the questions of Mañjuśrī. And I don't think that that's just a coincidence in that sense. I also wanted to point out that the name of that world was called Anudpata, unarisen. And of course, I did a whole talk a few Sunday nights ago about the very idea of Anudpata. It's so important to the sutra. So when they're talking about King Space from the land non-arisen, I don't think you really have to dig very deep to see that they're being rather, you know, symbolic in that way, right? So I wanted to point out those kind of few linguistic things that are very interesting. For me, when I read those things, it's so clear to me that they don't think that this, you know, that this is like an event that happened in the long past. This is very allegorical in that way. And so we have this allegorical story about King Space from the land of the unarisen, who had generated all of this merit for a very, very long time. And the king, sitting on all of this merit, thinks, what should I transfer it to? Should I transfer it so that I get reborn as a god? Ooh, he thinks, maybe I should transfer it so that I get reborn as a shravaka, as a monk. And right there, the sutra is telling you what I told you at the beginning, but it's doing it in story form. The sutra is referencing the old school Hinayana way of thinking about merit accumulation. The king, who represents that old school way of thinking, is like, oh, maybe I should transfer it to being a god. But then he's like, ooh, but maybe I should transfer it to becoming a monk in my next life. And again, that's because in the early form of Buddhism, that's all one could do with their merit, was use it to get a better rebirth. And if they were smart, they would use it to be reborn as a monk so that in their next life, they could actually transcend samsara. So the king is thinking that way, thinking, oh, maybe I should be a good person and transfer it to becoming a monk. But then the sky opens up, voices say, don't do that. Don't be so narrow-minded as that. Generate bodhicitta and transfer it to all sentient beings. And the king is like, that's a great idea. And so he does. And he generates bodhicitta. He makes the determination for anuttara samyak sambuddhi. And then he transfers all that accumulated merit to the benefit of all sentient beings. And wouldn't you know it, of course, that King Ubiquity, who transferred all that merit and generated bodhicitta, that was Mañjuśrī, right? Now, the one major, wild, crazy thing that happens in this sutra that you will not find this anywhere else. This is some really radical stuff. King Ubiquity predicted of himself that he would attain enlightenment. That's pretty wild. Now, of course, he makes the statement that, and if I'm for real, like if I'm really doing this, and it makes a point. He says, if I'm doing this without conceit, without self-interest in that way, but if I'm really, really serious about this, may it rain mandarava flowers, may music play, and may the earth shake in six ways. The earth shakes in six ways, music plays, and it rains flowers. And so we are to understand that Mañjuśrī or King Ubiquity, that it was a sincere vow in that way. The reason why I want to point this out, though, about King Ubiquity making the prediction of themselves, like, think about how that would have sounded if Mañjuśrī would have said it, rather than the Buddha telling you the story about it. It's very different. It's like one is this really cocky story about a bodhisattva who predicts of themselves, versus the other is this, like, the Buddha telling us about this bodhisattva. And my point is, if you are thinking about these things allegorically, that this was not a historical event, but if you're thinking about the story trying to tell us something, it's very interesting, this, the way that it's presented, where the Buddha tells us about Mañjuśrī, but it's not Mañjuśrī, but it is, but it isn't. And they make this prediction of themselves, but they couldn't really have said that of themselves. So it's just this really interesting, complicated Buddhist, I don't even know what you would call it in that way, but very interesting presentation of ideas. Cool. Any questions, comments, answers, ideas? Cool. I have one thing that I want to note about some things that the king said, actually things that the Buddha said, but that other Buddha, thunderous voice Buddha. So he said, he says in this poem, great king, be steadfast in cultivating all conditioning, and you will attain this broad, great, unsurpassable awakening. So I was curious really quickly. Sorry, one second. Well, I'll just, oh, there it is, yeah. So the Tibetan translate this as, great king, be steadfast in cultivating all practices. And I believe the other one is also practices. I just want to take one quick second to point out something about this word. In a lot of texts, a lot of Buddhist texts that you read, there's a word that gets translated as to practice, you know, like your daily meditation practice, your practice, right? Maybe you've got a yoga practice, but the idea of practicing. So I've shared this with a number of people, but I don't think I've maybe ever mentioned it in the Dharma Doors. And this is a great opportunity because the text says it so clearly. So I want you to know that the word that's being translated as to practice in Chinese, or what actually in Sanskrit, but according to the Chinese and also according to the Tibetan, the word is samskara. And you might know samskara as being one of the five aggregates, the fourth aggregate, which is about habits, about mental conditioning. But it's actually not just mental conditioning, it's conditioning of the body and mind. But the idea of samskara, the idea of being conditioned, it's actually really important to understand and know that 9 times out of 10, when you read a Buddhist text and they talk about practice, they are actually talking about conditioning, samskara. And my point is that I know that some of you may be under the impression that samskara, conditioning, is bad. But it's not bad. It depends on what you're conditioned to. Meaning, some people are conditioned to lie. They have a habit of doing it. They're conditioned to do that. And the idea of becoming a truth speaker, taking a vow of speaking truthfully and doing it, well, the idea is that when you cultivate that, when you practice that, you're creating a different conditioning. And it's the habit of being honest versus the habit of being a liar. And it's important to understand that about the skandhas, about the self, this idea that what makes this up is the body of form, the sensations, the perception, the way that we're conditioned, and then the conscious state that arises from those four skandhas. So the point is that skandha or samskara is not good or bad. It's what you're conditioned to do that determines whether something is kind of quote good or bad in that way. So here the Buddha, that other Buddha, suggests to the king that he should be steadfast in cultivating these conditionings or these practices, such as transferring merit to all sentient beings. Great practice, by which I mean great way to condition your mind towards generosity versus selfish hoarding. So that's the idea, is that we are conditioned to hoard. As creatures, we feel safer when we hoard. And the idea is that is a habit, that's a conditioning, and we can recondition ourselves or decondition ourselves out of those habits and create new habits that are healthy, beneficial, and lead to enlightenment. So on that note, I'm going to call it a night. Unless there were any last minute questions, comments, answers, or ideas. Awesome, then. That'll do it for me this evening. Thanks, Noe.